So the way in which the correspondence problem is made most obvious is in terms of random dot stereograms. For many people, that's really the definition of the correspondence problem. Let me tell you a little bit about that. The person who really developed random dot stereograms in the 1950s was Bela Jules, who was not the first to actually discover random dot stereograms, but was the first to put it in digital form, allowing many, many researchers to make random dot stereograms with computer algorithms and test them in a whole variety of psychophysical circumstances, which Jules did himself, but many others followed and made many observations that are relevant. So what is a random dot stereogram and how does it pertain to the correspondence problem? Well, first of all, let's describe the phenomenon itself. And I think those of you who can do what's called free fusion, who have the ability to look through the computer screen, and you all can do this with practice, I promise you. I didn't think I could do it until I got interested in this and practiced a little bit. If you fuse these two images in free fusion, just by looking through the computer screen, you will see an object that pops out in three dimension that looks like it is behind the surface that the rest of the dots comprise. And if you have trouble doing that, I suggest you take a piece of cardboard, just an envelope or something that blocks the two eye views, and put the piece of cardboard between the two stereograms and put your nose in front of that. Then you'll see the right one with one eye, the right eye, and the left one with the left eye. And you'll automatically fuse them, and the object will eventually pop out. So it's fun to do that. That's the basis of the amusement that comes from stereograms and auto-stereograms that were 10 or 15 years ago very popular in posters, in newspaper presentations, and so on. So it's fun to look at these things, but it has, in addition to being fun, a deep significance in terms of explaining stereoscopic vision. So how is a stereogram like this made? Well, let's consider the right eye view. The whole right eye view image is just a pattern of random dots made, as Jules showed, easily with an algorithm that you can now use on any laptop. What the experimenter does, or anyone who wants to play with this does, is to pick an area of the scene. Doesn't have to be a square, it can be anything. And in the view of the other eye, take that same square and shift it a little bit, just a few degrees. So that leaves a gap where it's been shifted and a cover-up area where it occludes the set of random dots that were there in the view of the other eye. Well, now what you have is two sets of random dots in the two images, and those sets of random dots are perfectly camouflaged unless you use stereoscopic vision. So if you look at these with one eye, you'll never see the object that's there. If you look at them with two eyes, you have to fuse the left and the right eye images, and then the object will pop out. Well, breaking camouflage, and much of the work that was done on this early on, before Jules got into the act and after, was funded by the military. Why? Because breaking camouflage is an important thing. So if you think of these sets of random dots as aerial views of camouflage tanks on the ground or something like that, if you think of using stereoscopy or images that have been created by stereoscopic cameras in an overflowing plane, you can imagine seeing tanks that you couldn't see otherwise by seeing them in stereoscopic view. Well, I don't think that's of much interest these days, but it certainly was in the 1950s. But that's how you make a stereogram, and it's pretty simple and can be fun to do. What's the message of the random dot stereogram for the correspondence problem? Well, remember I said before that in disparity, whether it's cross disparity or uncrossed disparity, that your job is to match P and Q in a cross disparity image, or match M and N in a view of this that is uncross disparity. And the question is, well, okay, how could you do that? That's image matching. You have to figure out some way that you can take the left eye image and the right eye image and match them. And if you think about images, well, maybe that's not so hard to conceive. But if you think about random dot stereograms, it's very hard to conceive, because matching this image and this image, which are nothing more than a set of random dots, how could you possibly do that? That's why random dot stereograms have been important in bringing to the forefront the correspondence problem. There is a challenge that you can kind of imagine ways around when you're looking at real images, but when you're looking at a completely camouflaged object like the shifted square in these two random dot stereograms, there's no way you're going to do that in any simple manner by using image information. Well, there's information in the image, all right, but it's only stereoscopic information. There's no image about objects, and that's really been the salient reason for so much work on random dot stereograms, that you get rid of all objects, you pare the problem down to its simpler dimensions, and those simpler dimensions involve the question of how can you match random dots in the left eye view and the right eye view, and that's no easy matter. So, as I said, this is one of the problems that's simply unresolved in stereoscopic vision. It's not really agreed upon to this day how it is that the correspondence problem is solved. There are many ideas using complex algorithms that entail phase information, disparity information, other information, but it's just not clear how that's done. And there may be other ways of thinking about it, but people are still unsure how this problem is solved today.